So without further ado, I think we should welcome Thomas Munro to the stage. Thomas.
Hi.
Hi, Thomas.
Hey, guys.
How are you?
Good. Good. So thanks for joining
from New Zealand. It's nighttime for you. I really appreciate
it. Nighttime is out the window.
Nighttime is out the window. You gave a talk at Citus Con last year on queues in Postgres, completely different topic. You are a Postgres hacker and committer, and you work at Microsoft. And your talk last year about queues in Postgres, and I know there's lots of controversy. Should you use Postgres for queues? No, I think you shouldn't. Yes, I think you should. But it was one of the most popular talks in terms of like overall number of views. So I'm not putting any pressure on you.
I see that topic's been raging on the internet in the past few days, I noticed. Someone wrote an article.
I saw some posts as well. Yeah,
it just keeps coming back. So you're going to be talking to us today, not about distributed Postgres, but about parallelism, right?
Yeah. Okay. So pretty much the opposite.
And don't tell us now, because we're going to leave the stage, and then you can dive in on what you're talking about. But Yelta, were we supposed to say anything else to make Thomas feel properly welcomed?
I think you did a great job. Okay. Welcome, Thomas, and take it away.
Thank you.
All right.
Okay, so I'm going to be talking about the opposite end of the spectrum from what Marco's just talked about, which is you've got a single computer, could be a server, could be a desktop or a laptop machine. Probably it's a server. And you want to make good use of the CPU cores that are in that one machine. And so for the past few years, along with many other people, I've been working on trying to make that happen in single node Postgres systems. All right, so my talk's called Parallelism in Postgres 15. I'm going to just give a super quick intro to who I am and why I'm talking to you about this. I started out to work a number of years ago on parallel hash joins. In order to make that happen, I figured out, along with a group of people from Enterprise DB who laid the groundwork for parallelism in Postgres. I figured out that there is a ton of different infrastructure that we needed along the way, and I finished up going away and building that first and then figuring out how to put together a way to perform joins using all the cores on your machine. But I've worked on all kinds of other bits and pieces in Postgres, and I'm quite interested in systems programming stuff like the kernel interface and, you know, trying to modernize Postgres and figure out how we make better use of memory and IO and threads and things like that. I'm based in New Zealand. My little joke here is that New Zealand has the highest number of Postgres committers in the world per capita. There's actually two of us. All right, so I should clear up what I'm talking about with parallelism. There's so many different levels of parallelism in a computer. Everything from a single thread in a CPU, of course, because of the hyperscalar nature of computers these days, and going back quite some time now, that's parallelism. And there's obviously vectorization. IO parallelism is getting more related to what I'm talking about because it is encouraged by CPU parallelism. But there's also all kinds of ways to network loads of computers together and get a really big database going. Citus is obviously a very good example of that. But there's also the built-in FDW system in Postgres, and there's many other kinds of projects that do massive parallelization of distributed databases. I'm not talking about any of that. I'm talking about a single machine with a whole lot of CPU cores, possibly one socket or two socket or more sockets, like CPUs with many cores inside them. And how do we make use of those? All right. So it's really interesting to look at the history over the past few decades of parallelism in relational databases. If you go all the way back to the 60s and 70s, there were mainframes that had many CPUs. I don't know anything about mainframes, but I know that it's a mistake to think that anything that happened in the Unix world started there. A lot of these ideas were researched and done on mainframe systems before that. But in the 80s, there was one particular machine that I think is really interesting. It was a sequent computer that the people at Berkeley who started the Postgres project had access to, and it had a lot of 386 chips in a gigantic box, and they had to figure out how to run queries that used all of those CPUs. So on this timeline here, I've shown Postgres at the top there, you can see that yellow color is Quell, because at the time it didn't use SQL. It used another query language, which lost the competition against SQL when SQL was standardized. Sort of Quell sort of fell away. But they got parallel query execution going. And then there was a sort of a time in the 90s where we don't actually have access to the source code in that little window before the modern open source Postgres project began in about 96. But in that dark window, we know that the parallelism in the old Postgres code was actually lost in the conversion to SQL. So Postgres is both very late to having parallel query execution and very early, which I think is kind of interesting. So in the 90s, all of these big, well-known relational database systems went parallel, because that's the time when expensive Unix workstations and servers started having multiple CPUs, and the kernels all started going SMP, symmetric multiprocessing, towards the end of the 90s, that was sort of the arrival of really cheap dual Pentium servers and things like that. But if you move forward to the 2000s, around about 2005, something really interesting happened. And this is a chart that came from, or a quote from Herb Sutter, who was writing in Dr. Dobbs' journal in 2005. He wrote, "The free lunch is over," because that was the point where, if you look at the blue dots there, the single thread performance of computers began to plateau. So your computer software stopped getting faster for free just by upgrading your hardware every year. But the number of cores went from one, which it had been for a long time, to higher numbers. And obviously, we now have machines with many cores. And there are pretty much no, every device, every phone, whatever, has loads of cores now. So if you want to get your stuff to go faster, you're going to have to figure out how to program them, which sounds pretty easy, but it's just not. And parallel programming is notoriously difficult. So we have a category of problems that are sometimes called embarrassingly parallelizable. Example I'm giving here is, suppose you want to paint your fence and or your wall or something like that. And if you want to do it twice as fast, you could ask your friend to help you, and they could perhaps start from the other end, and you could perhaps have four people doing it, and maybe it'll be four times faster. You can't really scale painting a fence perfectly forever. Like, if you invite a million people over to your house, you'll start running into contention problems, because maybe they won't fit in your garden or something like that. But generally, you can scale pretty well by adding more people to a problem as simple as painting a fence. And then suppose you want to add up a large pile of receipts. Excuse me. So you've got a huge pile of bits of paper, and you're grabbing the numbers and typing them into your calculator. You might get your friend to help you. And so you're going to have to cut the problem into two phases. You'll both grab receipts and add them up, and then eventually all the receipts are gone from the pile. And whoever takes the last one, the other person has to wait for them to finish. And then you've got the two subtotals, and you add them together, and you've got the result, right? So that's still pretty much embarrassingly parallelizable. We can see how to do that. And we can see that if you add 10 people and they all start grabbing receipts, maybe they start getting in each other's way, accessing the pile. So maybe they need to grab a handful at a time or something like that. And those kinds of things can be seen in all kinds of parallel algorithms. But to move to a trickier problem, I'm going to try to describe a join using socks. So suppose you have two piles of socks, left socks in one pile and right socks in another pile. And these socks are numbered, and your job is to match the socks up. And they're all jumbled up. So somewhere in there, there's a number 7 sock for the left foot, and somewhere there's a number 7 sock for the right foot. How are you going to do it? Well, even doing that with no parallelism, just one person trying to solve that problem, it's kind of tricky. So, you know, you might think of sorting them in some way, and then I could describe a sorting algorithm with socks, and it would be really horrible to listen to. But another way you might do it, which I'm going to try and describe a hash join, you might set up a grid of buckets, 10 by 10, and put numbers on them. And every time you pick up a sock, you check the last two digits. And if the last two digits on that sock are, suppose you've got 1,000 socks, right? So you look at the last two digits. And if it's 07, it goes into box 07. If it's 32, it goes in box 32, right? So in this way, you can take all of the socks in the right-hand pile one by one and put them into the right buckets. And when you've finished putting all the socks into the buckets, then take all the socks. It doesn't matter what order you pick them up in, right? Just randomly grab them. Every sock you pick up from the left pile, you find the right bucket, then you only have to search through the socks that are in that bucket. And suppose it was 1,000 socks and you had a 10 by 10 grid, you got 100 buckets. So there's only going to be about 10, well, the expected number would be 10, right, in each bucket. So and you could add more buckets and make it easier so that hopefully you can just find the matches very quickly. And in that way, you can match together all of the socks and put them in a pile. Now, suppose you want to ask your friend to come and help you. Can you do it twice as fast with two people? Well, pretty much yes, because with that algorithm, you both grab random socks one at a time. You both stick them into the buckets, into the right bucket of the right-hand side. And then you need to wait until everybody involved has finished putting all the right-hand socks into the buckets, right? Because nobody can start the next phase of taking the left-hand socks and finding the matching sock until they know that every sock, there's no socks in somebody's hands still. They've all got to be in the buckets, right? So we only have this one little bit of communication. But otherwise, it scales pretty linearly, right? Like the first phase, everyone's putting the right-hand socks into the buckets. Second phase, everybody's picking up random socks and finding the socks in the buckets and matching. In between, there's this tiny moment where everybody has to look at everyone else and say, right, have we done them all before we move to the second phase, right? So that's the kind of thing that we think about when we do parallel query execution. All right. So I'm now going to talk just a little bit about how we make before I get into how we make parallel query plans, let's quickly review how we make plans in general in a relational database. So a database generally is a typical relational database, not just Postgres, but many other similar systems, is a machine that you feed queries into, and something called the planner takes the query as input, some analyzed form of the query, plus a whole lot of statistics about the tables that it references, and a whole lot of settings that control the costs of things and various options that are available to it, and somehow magically spits out a plan. And that plan, I'm showing there in the middle of the slide as a sort of a tree of operations, can then be used to execute the query. And so you execute the query, and executing the query, you may execute that plan multiple times because if you use a prepared statement, then it's going to stick around and you can keep doing it. It'll be faster. You won't have to plan it again. And then executing it runs all the steps in that plan against the tables that contain the data and somehow spits out the results. All right. So how does the plan get built in the first place? Well, I'm not going to go into detail because it's pretty complicated, but generally the optimizer is cost-based in Postgres and in many other systems. The first thing it does is thinks about all the ways that it could access the base relations, the tables you mentioned in your query. It also has to think about all of the different ways it could join the tables that you mentioned. If you had joins in your query, for example, if you're joining tables A, B, and C, it could join A and B first and then join the result of that against C or the other order. Or if there are many tables, then there could be many, many possibilities. It quickly explodes. And it also has to decide for each join which of the three main join algorithms or strategies to use: merge joins, where you sort of zip things together that are in the right order, or hash joins, which are a bit like that bucket thing I was describing, or nested loop joins, which usually involve looking at an index, which works if you've already got an index, right? But if you haven't got an index, you might try the bucket thing with the hash join. And there's a bunch of other things to consider, especially involving aggregation, group by, and that kind of thing, and window functions, and all kinds of other complexities that get considered. Somehow we produce all these different things we call paths, which are basically little plans, and estimate the costs of them and figure out which one wins and which one is worth executing. All right, and it's based pretty much just on the expected time to run that query. So when parallelism came along in Postgres 9.6 and a few years ago now, it's been improved in each release since then. The basic approach chosen for now is to add more options to the planner. And those options involve parallel versions of some of the regular executor operations that we have. For example, a sequential scan is something in normal queries where you just run through a whole table and look at every tuple, right? And you might filter it. But basically, you're looking at each block in a table, and which is hopefully in cache, but maybe not. And the parallel sequential scan is the parallel cousin of a sequential scan, which simply gives different blocks to different processes. So each process that's executing the query will look at a different arbitrary subset of the data. it's a bit like with our two piles of socks. If you're scanning one of them, you're grabbing arbitrary handfuls, and you're both like, maybe there's two processes involved, and they'll both grab arbitrary handfuls until there are none left. So we don't know which socks each of the processes is going to receive. We just know that they're going to grab them on demand until there's none left, and between both of them, all of the socks will be picked up. Right, that's the basic concept. So we have this parallel sequential scan, which essentially distributes the data in some arbitrary fashion. And it's the same with an index scan. Then we have a bunch of different nodes, just a few actually, that have a special parallel variant. And that means that there's some communication between multiple processes. Append nodes is an example, and hash joins is another example. And then we have a gather node, which is a thing that collects all of the results from multiple processes, collects them together, and spits them out in one process. And that's the way we get results back to, that's going to have to be in there if you want to get the results back to a client. Another thing to talk about is partial and finalized aggregates. So normally in a query plan, I'm going to show examples of this in a second, so you'll see what I mean. But normally we would have, in the example of a simple count query, with parallelism disabled, you would see that here's a sequential scan on table T, which has an aggregate above it, and that's the thing doing the counting. The parallel version of that query plan has a gather node where the answer gets spat out. And above the gather node, you can see the finalization of the aggregate. Below the gather node, we've got multiple processes running, and that's where the subtotals are computed. So when I talked before about the about receipts and adding the numbers up, and that's happening in these worker processes, and they are adding some arbitrary subset of the values up, in this case counting. And then all of those subtotals get handed to the leader process, and it's going to do the final, you know, summing and spit out the answer. So the answer should be the same. And generally speaking, we find simple queries like this scale more or less linearly. The more workers you throw at them, the faster they'll go. Especially if you have some filtering going on in those scans, so that the CPU has to do a bit of extra work, and you're not perhaps limited by I/O or something like that. So there's a pictorial representation of three processes, where one of them is the leader process, and it's the one that has the gather node. The two worker processes that help it run that query just have the lower part of that query plan, and their job is just to get the partial aggregate number. So that shows three separate processes adding numbers or counting receipts or whatever it is that table represents. All right. So I'm now going to talk about I'm now going to talk about the way that we can influence the choice between using a parallel query and a regular non-parallel query, like older versions of Postgres would. So one of the most basic controls that affects this is the cost of setting up a parallel query, and there's this arbitrary number 1,000, which is a nice round number, which is used by Postgres when considering the cost of any plan to actually start up the parallel worker processes. Now, Postgres is showing its age here. Most other comparable systems use threads and would have a thread pool that would be able to help out with a query like this. I think we'll eventually get there with Postgres. At the moment, it's still using processes, and that's one of our weaknesses. That's a few problems to solve to get there. In any case, we somehow need to account for the cost of that. So, for example, on a typical Linux system, it might take a few milliseconds to start up a parallel worker process, which in the scheme of things is not that bad if you're dealing with a large analytical query. And essentially, what we're trying to do here is represent the fact that if you have a large analytical query, if you have regular OLTP type workloads where you're just updating single rows and inserting single rows, none of this stuff ever needs to run. It doesn't really matter. We want to make sure that it looks, there's a bit of a starting cost to any parallel query. So that's what that number represents. But you can set it to zero, and then you'll start seeing all of your queries using all of your select queries using parallelism or trying to, and probably it'll slow down a bit. For the very small queries, but it really pays off for the big queries where you get the linear scalability if you're lucky. So the next simple control is the it tries to capture the idea that every time a tuple has to be sent from a worker process into the leader process that's going to send the results back to a user, for example, or do further computation on them, there's a cost to that. So, for example, if you tell Postgres that you want to select all of the rows from some absolutely enormous table, it's probably not going to do the scan in parallel in multiple workers, because if it's really just reading them off disk and sending them back to you, and those worker processes are actually just going to have to first send them to the leader process so it can send them back to you, then it's actually a waste of time and there's no point in involving parallelism in that. But if the where clause in the query, as simple as this, can be determined to filter a lot of tuples out, perhaps running some expensive computation, perhaps doing some JSON transformation or, you know, something like that, where you're using a lot of CPU and only spitting out a small number of tuples, then it would make sense to have the parallel worker processes involved in helping you scan that table. So that the way that estimation is based on having some way to charge you a cost for sending tuples back to the parallel leader process. So those are two really basic settings that you can play with to try to convince Postgres to parallelize or not parallelize queries according to, for experimentation or to improve performance. All right, so the next question is, once we've decided we're going to use parallelism or not, or when trying to compare them, one of the factors is how many parallel workers should help with a given query. And the current system is quite primitive. It's based on rules. And this is probably something that'll change over time, but the current system that we've started with is based on some kind of idea of a driving table. That's not really a term that's in the manual, but it's kind of the way I think of it. There's a kind of a rule for figuring out where the biggest set of tuples is coming from that's feeding into a query, and I'll show an example in a moment. And so once you've sort of figured out which the driving table is, that you can either say, well, anytime I do a full table scan on this table, which might be some massive analytical table full of data that you want to crunch, you can actually explicitly set it to always use, say, 7 workers or something on that table with an altered table statement. But normally, the normal rule is based on this heuristic where we have this minimum parallel table scan size, and you can set that. And if your table is at least that size, we'll consider starting a worker. And every time it gets 3 times bigger, we'll add an extra worker, which is a very simple rule. So you can adjust that if you would like to see more or less parallelism according to your table size. And then probably most importantly, because most people who want to see parallelism probably have very big tables full of data, right? That's why they'd be interested in this feature. So they might be probably the most important thing to tweak, to experiment with this stuff, is max parallel workers per gather. It says for each gather node, which in many simple queries, there would only be one gather node that would appear in a parallel query. It's capped at 2. And that's kind of because we don't really, like Postgres has some default settings that are based on not knowing anything about the machines it's going to run on. So if you have a 64-core beast or more, then you'd almost certainly want to turn that up. All right. So I'm just going to show, so here's a query plan shown graphically, which shows a fairly typical example of a nested join. We've got 4 tables being joined together. There's some really big table, and it's being joined against many small tables. Perhaps the big table is sales, and the small tables would be customer and product and, you know, a couple of things like that. So those might be reference tables in some sense. The thing that's producing all the tables, this kind, the thing that's producing the huge number of tuples that's kind of driving this flow of tuples, in this case, is the thing that we want to parallelize on. We want to spin through the huge list of sales, and for each one, you get the right answer if in each process you go and look up the corresponding customer and so forth. So that I'm trying to explain here, that there's one particular table that probably, you know, in many queries, that's the one that's going to be used to drive the rule that selects the degree of parallelism. Okay, I'm now going to quickly run through a couple of different parallel query plan types. And these are focusing heavily on joins, mainly because that's an area that I've worked on quite a bit myself. There are other things that I'm not covering here. All right, so one kind of thing that join that works really well in parallel is a typical inner join where there's some large table that we scan through, and for every tuple we see, we need to go and look something up in some other table. And over on the top right-hand corner of this slide, I've tried to represent how you might think of the time passing when you're running this query. The blue bar shows in some abstract. Yeah, I'm not showing the actual numbers here. It's not a real query. But you ought to be able to get something like linear scalability from a query as simple as this. And one thing to note is that we didn't have to invent anything new to make these index scans for nested loop joins work. We just needed to get each process to be given a different subset of the tuples on the left-hand side of this this diagram. So that's where tuples get scattered, if you like, between the cooperating processes. Each process is free to go and look up the corresponding thing to perform the join in the other table, which might be, say, the customer's table or something. And between them, all of the tuples will be processed. Each one processes some completely arbitrary subset until the data runs out. So you might so the green bars there represent the fact that the same amount of work is done is split up by three, and a query like that might go three times faster. A hash join is essentially similar, except that if it's a very small hash table, if the table being joined against is relatively small, it makes sense to have each worker build its own mini hash table, and it's actually going to run that subplan in duplicate. So every single process involved in this join would, you could think of that as kind of broadcasting the data to each process, but it's essentially running the same plan on one side of this join, and to produce a set of private hash tables that are not shared, and no extra communication is required. I'm showing these nodes as blue because they don't know that they're in a parallel query. They're just doing their normal thing, but the parallel sequential scan is green. And that's my notation on these slides for knowing that it's parallel aware, and it hands out different tuples to each process. So if you look at the time chart on the top right hand corner of the slide, I've shown that there's a build phase where we build the hash table, and that's not got any. It's not going faster because of parallelism. And then there's the probe phase, which is, if we think of my example with matching socks, it's the phase, the build phase is when we're putting the right-hand socks all into the buckets, and then there's the probe phase where we're going through our socks and trying to find the corresponding ones. That phase can be done, can be made to scale pretty much linearly, a bit like a scan. excuse me. So in this, with a join like this, it makes sense if the hash table is very small not to bother with any communication between workers to get the hash table built. And it's okay to have this duplication when the table's small. But if we try to parallelize both sides naively, and we just put the parallel sequential scans on both sides, we wouldn't actually get the right answer from our query, because each process would build a private shared hash table that doesn't contain the whole set of right-hand socks. So basically each process would finish up building its own private hash table, and then from some subset of the right-hand socks, and then it would take some subset of the left-hand socks, and they wouldn't, it wouldn't be complete, so they wouldn't be able to produce the right answers. So for that, we need to use a shared hash table. And that involves this two-phase. And finally, here we see in the time chart in the top right-hand corner that in the first phase is then divided by three and goes much faster. That's kind of from the sock example. And then the probe phase is also linearly scaling. And so finally, we managed to get a hash join that scales linearly for both sides. So one of the things that can go wrong with this strategy, and probably one of the things that Postgres uses when they try to deal with large amounts of data at the moment, is memory management. And our memory management strategy is not very sophisticated yet, and that's something we need to do to continue to improve. At the moment, the amount of memory that any hash join, or in fact any executor node, but I'm focusing on hash joins here, can use is determined by the work mem setting. But it's also, and there's also in recent Postgres releases, there's this multiplier, so you can make it bigger by changing that. Surprisingly, one of the problems that we've run into with really large data sets is not actually that people set that too large and use too much memory and that everything melts down. Usually that works fine. The biggest problem we've run into with this type of thing with very large data sets is people having workmem set too low, for the surprising reason that that our main strategy for dealing with very, very large joins is to partition the data first. But then if you've got like very, very large tables that you're trying to build, like hash tables, and you're trying to partition them first, the amount of memory it requires just to track the number of partitions becomes excessive. And we also start doing like strange things like trying to open a million files and write partition data out to them, which doesn't work so well, as you might imagine. So I guess one of the biggest dangers at the moment with the current design is that if you're working with very, very large data sets and you're using completely default settings and you don't try and give it more memory to work with so that it can use a reasonably small number of partitions, some of its internal bookkeeping memory and management can overflow and you can start seeing out of memory errors, which has the maybe counterintuitive remedy that you need to increase your workmem so that it doesn't require so much partitioning. That's a problem that we are going to have to continue to work on and improve. So here are some of the things that prevent parallelism in Postgres. One of them is full outer joins. That's a feature that my colleague Melanie Plageman has been working on. So Postgres 16 should be able to do full outer joins in parallel. At the moment, those can't be processed in parallel. So if you use those in most queries, that it'll completely disable parallelism. Another example is FDWs, so a way to talk to other databases. Most of those don't support parallelism across the network. You know, when you're looking at a table from some other remote database using FDWs, a lot of things like that. There are some plans that can use FDWs well with parallelism, but not all. The use of curses, because we don't have the machinery required to let you fetch small parts of the data at a time if the data is coming from parallel workers. That's just not something we can do. And probably the biggest one is writing. At the moment, Postgres's parallel query planner and execution it's all based around selects. So that would be in the category of major projects. In fact, I've actually made a list of major future projects in this area that I hope over the coming years people will work on to make parallelism more, single node parallelism more mature. So one of the biggest ones is write queries, being able to insert, update, and delete in parallel. At the moment, this is all just talking about selects. A really large one is management of total memory resources and also IO and CPU, but for memory, that's probably the most obvious problem at the moment. Postgres is entirely based on users telling the system how much memory individual operations can take, rather than telling the system as a whole how much memory it should use and then letting it figure out how to allocate that efficiently for all of the parallel queries and even non-parallel queries that are running at the same time. Another one of the things that we need to work on is getting rid of the process model, which has been with us since 1986, the beginning of the project. Essentially, Postgres predates threads in standardized form, and getting out of the corner that the project painted itself into in early years is going to take some major engineering effort, but it's something we need to do. A couple of other areas that are kind of open problems at the moment are figuring out how to break the current executor design up into a different model so that more kinds of parallelism become possible, which is a fairly technical topic. Finally, there's, at the moment, we're not very strong on partition-based parallelism, where you would break data up and on the fly. That we can do joins that are based on partition-wise joins, where both sides of a join are partition tables and the partitioning scheme matches, but we don't repartition data on the fly to match an existing partition scheme or anything like that. And that's maybe something that that we should be researching for future versions. And that is the end of my talk. So thanks very much.
Hey, that was amazing.
Yeah, thanks, Thomas. That was great. I learned a lot.
You probably want to, maybe you were hoping I would tell you all the things that are great and not all the things that are wrong, but one of the things about being deeply involved in a project is your mind is full of the things that need to be improved.
I think that's part of being a good engineer, right? You're always looking, how can I engineer this to be better? Like, how can I improve, augment, adapt? I mean, okay. I don't know. My whole family is engineers, and so our dinner table conversations are all focused on how could that be better? How could that be optimized?
It's all wrong. Yeah.
There was one question on Discord that sounded very interesting to me. Are there any efforts to parallelize on the GPU?
I have heard of projects that do that kind of thing. I've not been involved in that myself, so I don't want to get the names wrong, but there are people who have talked about that using the custom scan machinery.
Okay, cool. So that could help with like machine learning kind of things, maybe.
I'm sure that's true, although I don't know anything about that subject. But yeah, right. The things that I've heard of are more based on feeding data to the GPU for filtering there or something like that. But I don't have any special knowledge of that.
Okay, right, well,
yeah.
I just want to say thank you for being back at Citus Con, for submitting your talk proposal. There were 129 talk submissions. We had a 27% acceptance rate. It was really hard making decisions. And there were some fabulous speakers and fabulous talks that we said no to. But thank goodness that we said yes to yours, because this was fascinating.
Thank you.
So, well, you're going to the Discord?
I am. I'm just on my way there right now.
Okay, awesome. So people can ask you questions there. Thank you. Yeah.